Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh, and a very good day to every one of you, those online and also here. Welcome to HDC's webinar series organized by Halal Development Corporation in collaboration with Dua Pharma Biotech Berhad in conjunction with the World Halal Conference WHC 2020, which is now in the 12th year. Congratulations, HDC, for continuously organizing this annual event since 2008 as the premier thought leadership platform for the global halal industry. I'm Rosie Osman, your moderator for this webinar session, the building blocks of the halal pharmaceutical ecosystem. I've been involved in the halal industry for more than 15 years already, and alhamdulillah, I've always had the opportunity of participating behind the scene in the WHC since day one, as event partner representing the company I used to work with and as participant when I took up the voluntary redundancy separation scheme in 2018. So this is my first time appearing on stage in front of the screen. So thank you HDC and Dua Pharma Biotech for entrusting me with this role. As mentioned by HDC's chairman in his speech earlier this morning, I hope some of you had managed to listen in, the halal industry as we know today is very different from what it was 40 years ago. Alhamdulillah, the halal industry has widened its scope beyond food and beverages, covering more consumable products besides F&B. As the products which is in focus today, pharmaceuticals. Why pharma? Well, because Allah's decree is for mankind to consume, which means not only eat and drink, but also ingest. And the consumption of halal and toyiban products is for sustenance of life, that is, to live and stay healthy. Due to the current COVID-19 pandemic and with the increasing halal awareness, the incoming demand for halal vaccines and medicines will be unavoidable. Alhamdulillah, I am glad to note that this challenge is being mentioned and discussed during this morning session, not only mentioned by the HDC's chairman during his speech, but was also discussed quite interestingly during the ambassador session. So I hope that you all can have an access to the morning session through HDC's Facebook later. I was very happy to note that the ambassadors are all very conscious of the Muslims' need and was once happy to hear the intention of Russia to work with Malaysia in developing halal vaccines. So without further ado, let's go into this webinar proper. We have the great opportunity to now listen to the views from the esteemed Professor Zahri Ismail, a very learned gentleman, the honorary professor from the School of Pharmaceutical Sciences, University Science Malaysia. He's the appointed member of National Fatwa Council for Malaysian Islamic Affairs since 2012 and fellow of the Academy of Sciences Malaysia since 2014. He was the recipient of HDC's Halal Scientist Award in 2010. Alhamdulillah, I've been blessed with the privilege of being under his chairmanship of the working group which was set up in 2009 to develop the world's first halal pharmaceuticals, the MS2424. In accordance with the guidelines and requirements for developing standards as stipulated by Malaysia's law, Act 549, and also by ISO. There are so many treasured exchanges, knowledge sharing moments with him, such as the time when we had together drafting the definition of halal built-in, one of his valuable brainchild concepts. This definition is now included in the latest revision of not only MS2424, but also in all the Malaysian halal standards. Let's now welcome Prof. Zahri and take a listen to his presentation on the topic of our webinar, the building blocks of the halal pharmaceutical ecosystem. Let's welcome Prof.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Assalatu wassalamu ala syifil mursalin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizing committees of accepting our contribution in this webinar series, and also to the chairperson for the introduction. And alhamdulillah, I think I'm going to use this occasion to try to resolve issues pertaining to halal aspects on pharmaceuticals. And we have heard many times, and even this morning, that halal pharmaceuticals is the coming thing that is going to going into our future products, future medicines. And for this afternoon, I'm going to talk about the building blocks of the halal pharmaceutical system. Due to the very regulatory nature of pharmaceuticals, that they are very highly controlled items, and they have to fulfill basic requirements of quality, safety, and efficacy. And for halal, of course, they have to also satisfy the halal parameters. All right, the scenario for the global halal pharmaceutical scene, there are a lot of efforts now globally by industry players in trying to fulfill the halal requirements. And in the Thomson Reuters report 2019-2020, they have shown that some countries, United Arab Emirates, Malaysia, Singapore, Jordan, and Egypt, have tried to go into and venture into this area. And other fast-moving countries like Turkey, Indonesia, Thailand, Japan, Korea are all aiming to make sure that they get involved in this particular area. And many of the things that we have to consider is that everything related to health matters in the countries concerned are standards set by the government concerned. And we find that in talking about halal pharmaceutical, since being highly regulated, they have to conform to certain guidelines and standards. Let us look at the Malaysian halal pharmaceutical journey, whereby, as mentioned by the chairperson, that we have started to think about halal pharmaceuticals way back in the late 1990s, and then following the standards set by the Halal Food MS 1500, and we managed to get things in place with the Halal Malaysia First Certification Procedure Manual, and then later on with the Halal Logistics, continued by the Halal Assurance Management System. And in 2012, we managed to publish the first MS 2424-2012, the Halal Pharmaceutical General Guidelines. And of course, when you start something new, you have to look at templates of any that is suitable to be made as the template for this particular document. And we actually used the food MS 1500 as the basis for definition, and also for the things that we are intending to put inside the standards. And the MS 2424-2012 was approved, and later on we have the Halal Pharmaceutical Certification Scheme, which used the MS 2424 to produce Halal OTC, halal over-the-counter medicines. And then we have the Halal Pharmaceutical Certification Schemes in 2017. And then in 2019, we embarked on the Halal Medical Device General Requirements, that is MS 2636, and also we did the first revision of the MS 2424-2019 Halal Pharmaceutical General Requirements with new additions. And with that, I think we have to launch something that is not done anywhere else in the world, that something that we have to embark on and to start this journey to make sure that it's done properly. Of course, in taking up medicines by the professionals, by the healthcare providers, in a modern scenario, the patient needs to be made known what sort of medicines they're taking. And then they should understand also the nature and the origin of the proposed medication. And this is part of the informed consent as a first step showing respect to their beliefs. And then patients should be encouraged to make informed decisions regarding their proposed treatment. And this is happening in the advanced countries. Yeah? As you can see, there are already publications in the renowned the Pharm School Journal on things related to halal and also on informed choice of medicine taking, whereby drugs of porcine origin and clinical alternatives published by the National Prescription Center by the UK. And to talk about pharmaceutical development, we can't deny the fact that it takes a long time. Yeah? A long time from discovery until clinical testing, manufacturing, storage, and so on. So we need to say that if you want to talk about halal built-in concept of halal pharmaceutical, then you should talk about halal drug discovery, halal product development, halal manufacturing, and then halal storage and distribution, and of course, sales and marketing on halal products. So we are not going to reinvent the wheel. Yeah? They are already in the market, already in the monographs of established pharmacopoeias, products or drugs or materials that are used in the industry that are already deemed halal. Yeah? We have done this homework and we have looked through the major pharmacopoeia and we find that only about 10% or less are problematic items that can annul the halalness of the product. And when we talk about halal pharmacopoeia, then we are also telling about how the industry will shape the new spin-off framework for the ecosystem. Yeah? So when you talk about halal pharmacopoeia, you're talking about the nature of the products to be produced. And for that, you have to make sure that you have the proper research ongoing, then the laboratory services to make sure that you can determine the halal aspect of that particular item. And then, of course, the regulatory services, and we also need the human resource development. And of course, the stakeholders themselves, they have to be involved. Eh? And the most important thing is the manufacturers themselves. They have to manufacture all these products labeled under halal. Eh? So this is what we consider as the total halal ecosystem that need to be in place. Eh? And of course, as for the current pharmaceutical system, they are already in place. But now when we talk about halal, then we need to look at how to convert it to so that it can also cater for the halal pharmaceutical. Looking at the Malaysian standard MS 2424/2019, we have defined what do you mean by halal pharmaceutical. Basically, it is nearly the same as halal food. Yeah? And it does not contain any parts of products or animals that are non-halal, or any parts of products or animals which are not slaughtered according to the Islamic way. And then do not contain impure materials called najis according to the Sharia. And also they are safe and efficacious for human use according to prescribed dosage of quality and hygiene. And they are not prepared, processed, or manufactured using equipment contaminated with impure or najis according to the Islamic ruling. and they do not contain any human parts or its derivatives that are not permitted by the Islamic Sharia. And then, of course, during preparation, processing, handling, packaging, storage, and distribution, all must conform to the halal aspect of of these things. So basically, this project of halal pharmaceutical has already gone up to the international level. So with our 24, MS2424, the OIC under the SMIT, of Standards Methodology Institute of Islamic Countries, they have adopted Malaysia as the secretariat for us to look into what we call this halal pharmaceutical issues. They call it Technical Committee number 16. So we have been entrusted as the chairman, and that means we try to harmonize what is available in the Islamic countries in terms of pharmaceutical products. And in the year 2018, at the Istanbul World Halal Summit, there is a statement on the declaration, and I'll read to you the declaration number 7, that it puts emphasis on the importance of authenticity tests and testing methods. And these tests and testing methods are available in the monographs. And number 8, it promotes innovation in production of halal pharmaceuticals, vaccines, biological products, excipients, and enzymes. That means we are trying to tackle all the difficult areas in manufacturing of halal, or in fact, in pharmaceuticals themselves, because these are the issues, the critical points that we must overcome. And by taking into consideration the government rule in putting rules regulating the importing and producing halal pharmaceuticals. And then number 9 is more interesting, also promotes developing halal pharmaceutical university curriculum and the establishment of halal pharmacopoeia as basic blocks in the halal pharmaceutical field. So we are talking about building, building blocks for the halal pharmaceutical ecosystem. This is the message that we want to put in, that is, halal pharmacopoeia is a main part of the building block. And probably some of you who might not have known the what do you mean by pharmacopoeia or halal pharmacopoeia, is basically that it's a document. It consists of a compilation of monographs, and the monographs describe the ingredients that are available, they are put in the medicines, they are formulated into medicines. And for example, we take an example, the British Pharmacopoeia 2012, which we have studied, and also the United States Pharmacopoeia 2012, that without this document, even though you have the MS2424, you can't proceed, because the MS2424 is only a guideline. If you want the details, then you look at the monographs of the pharmacopoeia. And this is the crux of the matter, whereby the pharmacopoeia, being a useful and important document, and it compiles a compilation of individual monographs of pharmaceutical items used in medical practice. And in advanced countries, they have to have a commission. Usually this commission is being put in place by the health professionals through the ruling done by the parliament and so on. And then in the pharmacopoeia, you have information on the description, the source, the manufacturer, and the method of analysis presented in a structured manner to facilitate its use, and as an important reference to check on authenticity, quality, use, and analysis. And of course, for halal pharmacopoeia, we need to have, it is an urgent thing, to have the halal pharmacopoeia in place, because currently, there's no comprehensive list of pharmaceuticals from halal or non-halal sources. You have to bear that in mind, because when the people in Britain or America or Europe or all over the world, when they make the monographs for their pharmacopoeia, they have no consideration at all for halal. So there's no comprehensive list for halal alternatives. So we have to put that list and no halal medicine has been prescribed when halal alternatives are available. These are sort of things that we have to look into the details. And then if you want to have patient right and so on, no clinical procedure for choosing suitable alternatives from halal or other sources under different situations and scenarios. I think this will be discussed later on. And what sort of products and information do we expect on the work for halal pharmacopoeia? Because this project involves analyzing and classifying pharmaceuticals into various categories from current established pharmacopoeias, from the British pharmacopoeia, United States pharmacopoeia, the European pharmacopoeia, Chinese pharmacopoeia, and the Japanese pharmacopoeia, to establish a comprehensive database. Yeah? And of course, we need to have guidebooks and software containing comprehensive information about the origin of the pharmaceuticals, and then the halal status and alternative sources. And we also need to have what is the views of a country like Malaysia, whereby we have a system of fatwa, whereby they can look at particular items to be given rulings and so on. So we expect the products and information from this sort of activity. Information center providing halal services for professionals, industries and consumer. And then we have halal drug utilization under different situations and scenarios. And then we have drug information system providing data or information on compliance to establish halal standards for the pharma industry. And then produce general documents for public and patient use. And also internet basis specializing in halal farm schools. And to set the scenario, we take an example. For example, this British Pharmacopoeia 2012. It contains about 3,200 monographs. Some pharmacopoeia, they contain more. For example, the USP contains more. And then from our initial screening of the 6 volumes of this BP, we only consider about 129 considered truly haram. But of course, the screening doesn't involve vaccines, blood preparations, and also homeopathic preparations, because these are what we call as compound medicines. It made up different ingredients, and for that, the individual ingredients need to be seen separately. These are the 6 volumes of the British Pharmacopoeia, and of course, each and every one of them have been used or is being used for different purposes. Volume 1 and 2 for medicinal substances. Volume 3 is for general monographs, specific monographs, and then volume 4 for herbal drugs. And for me, I think the volume 4, since they mainly comes from herbal sources, we don't have any problem with that, actually. Yeah? And volume 6 on the reference spectra, and the volume 6 is for the veterinary items. All right. In terms of the division of the 3,000 or 4,000 sort of monographs or compounds that is described in the pharmacopoeia, we can safely divide them into 3 color codes. That is the red list, the grey list, and the green list. Meaning, the red list are the no-no items for halal. They constitute mainly from products from the pig or animals which are deemed non-halal. And there are many of them. And then we have the grey list, sometimes coming from sources of dubious nature, from insects, and then from even human source, and from animals which are halal but they are not slaughtered. And of course, the green list, which constitute a major part of the items in the pharmacopoeia, they consist of synthetic materials, and then from plant material, from semi-synthetic material, from microbes, and then even from recombinant DNA. And let's see some of these examples. Okay, what you see here is the list of ingredients from pig source, from porcine source, that is currently available in use in the pharmacopoeia. So we have the hormones from adrenal glands, cortisone, corticosteroids, and so on, and then from the blood, that means the blood from the pig, from the blood fibrin, plasmin, hemoglobin. Yeah? They are very useful items to be used as medicines. And then from the brain itself, from the gallbladder, from the heart, and until the end from the skin, whereby you have the gelatin, the collagen, and so on. So there's a whole list. What we need to know now is whether we can find alternatives for these items or not. Yeah? And from our reading, there are alternatives. Yeah? All right, in the British Pharmacopoeia, we'll give you an example of how we want to tackle converting the current pharmacopoeia into halal. Yeah? For example, this is the monograph from the British Pharmacopoeia describing stearic acid. And stearic acid is from stearin. And by definition, stearic acid used in the industry and is very commonly used not only in the pharma industry, but also in the confectionery, in various other industries. And it consists of mainly stearic and also palmitic acid. It is a combination of two acids, fatty acids. And they are obtained from fats or oils of vegetable or animal origin. So the problem here is that the British pharmacopoeia, they can accept whether it comes from animal or plant source. But for halal pharmacopoeia monographs, we only accept from plant sources. And the fats from animal sources, for example, from porcine, from pig fat, or even from tallow, from any other animal's fat, is of course no-no. Yeah? And then of course, how do you differentiate one from another, and how do you analyze them? These are the things that is in the monographs. To tell you that we are not the first to embark on halal or alternative here, yeah, for this particular example, stearate, because the Jews, yeah, they themselves, they already produce products of halal, of kosher stearate. And you look at the thing in red, it's mentioned that the medicine stearate, kosher standard, was developed as the first generation of vegetable-derived replacement for animal-derived products. This is the sort of thing that we are trying to use. Eh? That means we don't accept animal-based stearates. And we have an example here. And also it can be certified to meet the requirements of the international pharmacopoeia. Insulin is a very interesting thing. Okay, this is insulin that appears in the British pharmacopoeia. And you can see that it is described in this manner. And they can differentiate insulin, of course, very important for diabetes, that you can differentiate insulin from pig, from human insulin, and from bovine insulin using this technology, yeah, that is found in the analytical methods. For those who are work in the lab, they use this data and this method to differentiate the various insulin, yeah? Using the various fragments that appear in the spectrum. And then they can also refer which one contains human insulin, which contains the porcine insulin, which contains the bovine insulin. So you need to know laboratory work for you to differentiate between the various insulin. In terms of human insulin, we have a problem here also. You look at the definition, human insulin is produced either by enzymatic modification and suitable purification of insulin obtained from the pancreas of the pig, or by a method based on recombinant DNA, yeah, technology. So meaning to say that human insulin is not yet confirmed halal. You need to differentiate those human insulin which are made partly from the pig insulin, and those which are made based on recombinant DNA. And of course, they give methods of how to differentiate those which are derived partly from the pig insulin and those which are derived from the recombinant DNA. And this is the current method that is being used, also shown in the British Pharmacopoeia. Things also happen for the other products like heparin, because heparin, very important, it's prepared from the lungs of oxen or from the intestines of oxen or pigs or sheep. So we have to know how to differentiate the various source of protein. All right, I will go very fast since my time is up. What we call as the red list, and also some the grey list, and also those what we call as the list categorized as red to green. That means originally is from sourcing from animals which are not halal, and then through biotechnology they convert it into green alternatives. And then of course we have also analogs synthesis, chemical synthesis from animal sources, that means as alternative, and also from recombinant DNA technology. And there's some few monographs which did more investigation, especially the ruling from the fatwa, especially those coming from insects, because in some countries they are allowed, in some they are not allowed. For example, colorants from certain insects used to color our pharmaceuticals, our confectionery, and so on. They are commonly found in the market, and we need to have a ruling on them. And then also monographs from animals obtained live without killing the animal, from bear, from horse, from rabbit. That means they harvest the material from a live animal. And then I think from the marine sources, coming from fish, shark, salmon, and so on, for us in our mazhab, we have no difficulty. This problem is no problem setting them as halal. But in some mazhab, they have problems in putting this thing as halal. All right, here is a so-called the general summary done by my former students. We have looked into the British Pharmacopoeia, the European Pharmacopoeia, the Japanese Pharmacopoeia, and also the United States Pharmacopoeia. In terms of numbers, monograph numbers, the USP have got the highest, that means 4,500 monographs. And then in the red list, from the BP, we find 27 having sources from pig source, and then European Committee, European monograph, about 21, and the Japanese Pharmacopoeia, about 4. And then for the grey list, from bovine sources, you have the numbers here. And then also what we call as from red to green, that means originally it was a red item, and then through chemical synthesis, we managed to produce the synthetic molecule, and then also through DNA technology. So these are common modern things that we hope we can resolve the issues on the red list. All right, there are some more that needs the opinion and investigation, further investigation by our ulama. That means about getting materials from animals without killing the animal. For example, from rabbit, from horse, and so on. And you can find them in the various British, in the various pharmacopoeia. And then from human urine and blood plasma. There are several items there. What is the ruling? And then from bird and chicken, we have also a couple. And from insects. And then halal ingredients from animal sources, as I mentioned just now, from marine sources. There are quite a number of them in the pharmacopoeia. So, in conclusion, when we want to turn the pharmacopoeia, the world pharmacopoeia, into halal pharmacopoeia, which is crucial for the development of halal pharmaceutical, then of course you need to have a lot of collaboration with the industry, the regulatory, and the researchers. And we find that some multinationals have shown interest. You see, when USM said that they want to produce the halal pharmacopoeia, suddenly the next week, the Merck, people from Merck International, they call USM to say how can they collaborate very fast. Yeah, and now the Korean pharmacopoeia also, they wanted us to turn their pharmacopoeia into halal Korean pharmacopoeia. So this is something that we need to be prepared. And then national, regional, and global efforts need to be harnessed resources in addressing the various aspects of halal pharmaceutical. And we require examining and sieving through the origin of all known compounds. Because if you look at the halal index, there are about nearly 60 items coming from the pig. But modern technology, you can turn them using recombinant DNA and so on, and through synthetic methods, you can turn them into halal alternative. And then a concerted effort amongst committed and knowledgeable individuals is very important for us to produce this halal pharmacopoeia. And then we need to have a comprehensive web database so that all these things that we have mentioned now can be compiled and used by the industry. So with that, I think I end my talk, and thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi
wabarakatuh. Thank you very much, Prof. It's always a pleasure to learn, unlearn, and relearn from Prof. By the way, you can start posting your questions online, and we shall address them later at the Q&A session. Now that we have gained some insights on the building blocks of the halal pharmaceutical ecosystem, the basic things that are put together to make halal pharma exist to what it is and where it is now, from drug discovery, clinical trials, manufacturing, to prescription, in addition to what else is needed to strengthen its existence and the halal built-in concept, especially halal pharmacopoeia, as mentioned many times by Prof just now and explained by him, let's now discuss another important element, the soft side of the ecosystem, which is the topic of the panel discussion, stakeholders' role in respecting informed decision on halal pharmaceuticals, focusing on two key aspects, stakeholders and informed decisions. So, wouldn't you agree that we, you and me, can be playing various contributing roles in the industry? That we are the soft side of the building blocks and we are the stakeholders of halal pharma? And that the most crucial role that all of us are undertaking is that of the consumer. Therefore, that's why we matter. We matter in ensuring the sustainability of halal pharma for the benefit of ourselves and the ummah as a whole. We matter because we are the ones who make the decisions on the choices about something, be it to consume, to provide the products or services, to govern, to research, etc. But these decisions should be informed decisions. Choices are made upon considering the knowledge and information relating to the options that we need to decide upon. So, let's now discuss this further with insights from our esteemed panelists, Tuan Haji Amrah Hibuang, President of the Malaysian Pharmaceutical Society, MPS, and Ms. Rusilawati Ahmad, the Deputy Director, Center of Products and Cosmetic Evaluation, National Pharmaceutical Regulatory Agency, NPRA, the Ministry of Health, Malaysia. We'll start first with Tuan Haji Amrahi, whom I also have the privilege of contributing together in spearheading halal pharma since we first met 10 years ago, when he was then the Chief Pharmacist of University of Malaya Medical Center, UMMC. He was promoted to Deputy Director Professional before retiring from government post in 2015. I specifically mention retired from government post because he is still actively contributing to the profession and industry. He's a member of the Malaysian Pharmacy Board, Malaysian Poison Board, National Antimicrobial Resistance Committee, National Patient Safety Committee, and National Medicine Policy Steering Committee. Of course, not forgetting, Tuan Haji Amrahi is also a member of the MS2424 Working Group. Encik Am, welcome and thank you for being here with me to share your experience and when you were in UMMC. And I believe even now when you are the president of MPS. What is it from the experience that you have encountered, observed and resolved in informed decision making, particularly those relating to the halal status of medicines? I'm sure you have a lot to share. Please, the mic is yours now.
Okay. Thank you, Rosie. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. I think first of all, I want to say a big thank you to the organizers for inviting me to share my thoughts and experience on the topic. I think we have to go to the definition first. When we say that, to make a decision, it has to be based on facts, and this is very important, especially so if we have to talk about informed decision making. And when we cover this area, it is actually a two-way communication process between a patient and one or more health practitioner. And this is very important when we say that the patient is the center of all the that involve the input from all the healthcare professional. And this is very important because this is very important in terms of quality medical care when you make decision. And because of that, we are able to make in terms of making it as an informed choice. So the issue will actually look into how are we going to address, say, in clinical situation. I think just now even Prof mentioned about things that is not halal, you know, in any setting. It can be in a hospital, it can be even in a community pharmacy and so on. So this is actually a very valid thing that we need to know. And if you look from a bigger perspective, who actually has all this information, if not the pharmacist? So I think in any setting, the pharmacists have all this information, especially when they are actually in charge of pharmaceutical, you know, everything about pharmaceutical. So this is very important. So this is what happened during my experience in the UMMC way back in 1998, where, you know, my top management saying that Amrahi, you know, you are in charge of medicines, and I want to know what is the status of the halal or haram medicine in the hospital. That is right from the very beginning when we talk from the point of the management, because this is something that I have done. Yeah. So at that time, you know, being the chief pharmacist and have access to medicine, and you can see from my position at that time, how I'm going to go about it. At that time, we don't have DAKIM. Yeah, we don't have, I don't have any access to fatwa. What you call it, and then also lack of what you call sort of religious teaching, because I didn't come from a religious school, you see. So these are things that I have to start, you know, from zero to make sure that I'm able to actually address all this, okay, that relate to medical treatment and one of it is actually halal. So if you are in my position, okay, what is the best that I can do in that position? Because I have the information, I must share this information to the doctors, to the nurses, okay, to fellow pharmacists, to my staff, and also to patient. If I not able to provide this, then I don't think I play my part. So this is something that need to be done. So what I've done basically at that time was actually to go into my inventory, right? Go into my inventory, right? When I go into my inventory, so what can I get from my inventory? Right? Number one, okay, I can use the information, right, from the packet insert, right? I also can get the information from the what you call whatever packaging, because this all is required at the point of, you know, when you actually register a product. And we did do this study with colleagues from the Department of Pharmacy in the Faculty of Medicine at that time. Mm-hmm. And from there, we are able to screen through, you know, the whole formulary and see what are the drug that is actually of issues. And then we can find out from this, you know, to see what we can do with the information. So yes, what Prof say is very clear that not many per se, but there are issues. There are issues. Okay, it's not many, but there are issues in clinical practice. So this is something that we need to do. For example, okay, if you talk about even a capsule, it is an issue. Okay, it's an issue because so many medicine are produced in capsules. So once you have a capsule, then you have an issue. The other one is even in the tablet form, when you talk about what are the material that they use, it is an issue. But I'm sure at the point of registration, it's all they have to declare. Right? They have to declare. So I presume at that time, when I have this, I'm sure that I can at least trust the information. When after that, I can give to all these stakeholders. So and this is where we move into what you call looking into what the Prof said just now in terms of the green list, or even the grey list, and even in terms of something that is green list. I mean, we can use. And this is very important for the fact that the not only the one that I did in 1998 when I did that study, and then further I can see that people also have done this. Okay, I can see, you know, even our colleagues in UITM have done all this sort of awareness, what you call in terms of awareness about halal pharmaceutical, the perception, and also the knowledge. So all this have been done. I have also done the certain thing in terms of students from the Sharia. They do discuss when they talk about the fatwa, about medicine, they do discuss with me and so on and so forth. And then the other thing, of course, I think there's one master student from IIUM which actually even go through the, in fact, involving the whole database under MPRA. So I think these are things that the first step is to get the correct information so that we can give to the patient. After that, then we go to the crux of the matter. Okay, and when you go to the crux of the matter, this is very interesting for the fact that this: how are doctors going to address this? Mm. How are nurses going to address this? How are pharmacists going to address this? Especially now, when the pharmacists play a clinical role. So more so when you become a clinical pharmacist, then you want to make sure that you have the knowledge of all this so that you can provide. Okay, I want to share with you what you call a scenario. Okay, in clinical setting. Okay, we take up a case. All right, I think Prof also mentioned about heparin. Okay, let's look into this case. All right, okay, if you talk about a patient, okay, for example, for DVT, deep brain thrombosis, okay, and we have to address the DVT. All right, and we can see that even on this, all right, what is the gold standard being used in hospital? Okay, so the thing that came up, because it's actually to address this symptom, of course they will use heparin. And heparin is an issue, like what Prof say, heparin is an issue. So is it from bovine or is it from porcine? So the pharmacist need to know, okay, because the pharmacy have to relay the message to the doctors or the nurse and so on. And then from bovine base. But we also have to know, what is, even from bovine, is it in line with Islamic perspective? So that's also another issue. All right? And then, okay, so if, for example, see we have a patient, okay, having DBT, all right? And we have to start the treatment, all right? And do you think that we should actually inform the patient that, this is actually from animal source and from this? So because we want to make sure that, you know, that the patient understand. And this is something that has been mentioned in term of informed choice. They need to know, okay, what is actually the source, and we have to do that. All right, but the issue with heparin is the fact that, you know, you want to start on heparin, then the patient got to stay in the ward. Mm. So there's another aspect that we need to consider, okay, because not all will be able to be in the ward for some reasons, okay. They don't want to be in the ward. Maybe they prefer to go outside of the hospital. Then the alternative treatment will come. That means we are talking about low molecular weight heparin. Okay, of course the famous example will be Clexane. Okay, where Clexane will be used, you know, for this. Alright? And of course everyone knows that Clexane, you know, is from a porcine base. Right? So, how we have to inform, okay, do you want heparin or do you want Clexane? It's another issue that we need to address. And then, after that, then we can see that, you know, I mean, it's an issue, because if you say heparin from bovine versus Clexane, it is an issue. So, we have to discuss with the patient and so on and so forth. That's why. After that, then when fondaparinux come to the market, okay, so what are the issues? Now we have alternative. We found a paradox, okay? And this is what very interestingly, Prof, is the fact that because of this Clexane and found a paradox thing, yeah, we have a fatwa ruling on this. This is a fatwa ruling saying that if we have Clexane, you cannot give found a paradox. That is actually the fatwa. So in clinical situation, it's very different. Okay, even though we have all this fatwa, but in clinical situation, it's very different. All right, so we must get all this, you know, we must get all this information so that we can present to the patient. Okay, because we are talking about giving them the information and they are able to choose. Because I think this is very important when you talk about concordance, as what been done in other countries, where you must give a choice. It's not a right or a wrong, you know. But there are other things that we need to consider, you know, other than all this, you know, for example, staying in the hospital, right? Or the cost of Clexane, or the cost of fondaparinux. So these are all issues, and some of these may not be available in the clinical setting. Yeah. So the pharmacists have to have to play their role. So we really need to upskill ourselves. To provide all this, and all the choice of the medicine will be very different based on the availability. Okay, what can be used in such circumstances? I think I've given a very good example of how, you know, things can get very very different in clinical situation, and the doctor, the nurses, and the pharmacists really have to be well knowledge and to be well informed of how to handle this. So I have given you a good scenario for discussion.
Yeah,
thank you.
Indeed, it's very interesting because the decision actually falls on us, the healthcare providers, like the doctors, the nurses, the pharmacists especially. They are the people with the knowledge to share with us what choices are available for us to make the decision. At the end of it, it is us who make the decision. Can you imagine way back in 1998 how Encik Am investigate, go through all the papers without the liberty or the luxury of the internet and computer as we have now? So I really salute you, Prof. and Encik Am, you know, from all these years that they have been building up this ecosystem, right? So We've heard from Cik Amrahi, you know, what informed decisions are. We are the one responsible to make that informed decision. Their task is to provide us with the information to make the decision. And the elements that are involved is not only is the product product A, B, C, but does product A can fit in into our body? That's also a main concern. So when it comes to halal, haram, there are a lot of elements that we need to consider, that we need to, you know, be conscious about before we jump to a conclusion and say no or yes, right? Because at the end of it, it's our peace of mind. Yeah? Our peace of mind that we are consuming it with blessings from God. So, thank you, Encik Am, for sharing your experience with us. And should you need further clarification, I'd like to emphasize again that you can post your questions online and we will address them later during the Q&A session. Please remember to write your name, the organization that you are representing, and the country that you are from. Thank you. So we've heard earlier from both Prof. Zari and Encik Am about the involvement of Malaysia's Ministry of Health, particularly the NPRA, in halal pharmaceuticals and informed decision making. So we now have the privilege to listen directly about their roles, fittingly represented by the Deputy Director, Center for Product and Cosmetic Evaluation, Ms. Rosilawati Ahmad. Welcome and thank you for joining us in this session. It's an honor to have the Secretary to the Drug Control Authority to give some insights on how the DCA ensures that the registered pharmaceutical traditional health supplements in Malaysia are safe, efficacious, and of quality. You know, these three elements are the underpinning wholesome toyiban aspects that goes hand in hand with halal. I think from the morning you've heard the coin word halalan toyiban. So this is what it is. Halal, which is permissible, and toyiban, which is wholesome, that is represented by what NPRA is doing. The safety of the product, the efficaciousness, the effectiveness, and the quality of the product. So in Malaysia, the Halal Competent Authority, JAKIM, and the state religious councils will reject. They won't entertain or process the application for halal certification if these products did not pass the first gatekeeper and they are not duly registered by DCA. So, Puan Rose, could you please share with us the essential requirements which DCA impose on pharmaceutical manufacturers and importers to safeguard the quality and well-being of Malaysians?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Assalamualaikum and very good afternoon, everyone. Okay, with regard to the question for safeguarding the well-being of the people and also improving quality of medicine in Malaysia, I would like to introduce the Drug Control Authority first. Actually, the Drug Control Authority was established under control of drug and cosmetic regulation in 1985. And then this Drug Control Authority was given a task to ensure the quality, safety, and efficacy of product through the registration activity, and then also inspection and licensing premises and the post-registration activities. So, and also NPRA is the agency under Ministry of Health and act as a secretariat for Drug Control Authority. Okay, in terms of standard and requirement for registration, the product approval process normally require a company to submit a dossier which comply with the our main criteria, which is quality, safety, efficacy. This can be done through the evaluation of dossier or scientific data containing analytical data of all of the product before they can market it in Malaysia. And also, this registration requirement normally are based on the standard set by the international level, such as WHO, and then ICH, International Cooperation Harmonization, as well as a guideline from the mature reference country, such as European Medicine of Authority, and also United States Food Drug Administration. And then this is international standard set by international level. And also in terms of regional standard, which is ASEAN level. So we under ASEAN ACCSQ PPWG product working group, we have established a few guidelines under this ASEAN, which is, for example, ASEAN Common Technical Dossier, ASEAN Common Technical Requirement, and also other technical guidelines such as Stability Studies Guideline, ASEAN Process Validation Guideline, ASEAN Variation Guideline, and also ASEAN Bioequivalent and Bioability Guideline. So this is regional level. Also, for national level, which is MPRIA, so MPRIA have issued, have established registration guideline named as Drug Registration Guidance Document, which can be downloaded in our MPRIA portal. So as a drug control authority, we have issued also directive and also circulars related to the new policies related to registration. Okay, for example, that yang just now I mentioned regarding technical requirement for the for the purpose of registration of product. For administrative requirement, for example, if related to halal, so drug control authority has imposed a policy that all product they have to declare their, if the product containing any source of animal or any source of animal in their formulation, they have to declare in the label. This policy also required for product containing porcine. So every product containing animal or porcine, they have to declare in the label. This is a mandatory requirement. For voluntary requirement, we allow product registered product to put halal logo, whether from JAKIM or state halal authorization, to put their logo in the label also. So far, we allow product under category cosmetic, traditional and health supplement, and also OTC product, over the counter product. At the moment, we haven't give approval for product containing shadow poison to put halal logo in the label. Okay, and then just now I mentioned the registration requirement. And also other requirement need to be comply with. Comply is good manufacturing practice for the manufacturer, and good distribution practice for the distributor, and a good laboratory practice for lab, and then good clinical practice for the clinical trial lab. And then MPRIA also monitor the compliance of the quality of the product through the post-market activity to make sure they have complied all the stipulated requirement imposed. And also, MPRIA also monitor safety and efficacy of the product in the market through pharmacovigilance activities. Okay, that's all. Thank you.
So interesting, Interestingly, I noted that Jakim has also appointed you as the panel member of Halal Certification Malaysia since 2019. Could you give some insights on how that appointment contributes towards availability of choices for stakeholders to make informed decision? Because I believe from what you said earlier that the halal logo can only be put on health supplements and over the counter, but not yet for scheduled poison.
Yes.
Could it be the reason of not sufficient availability of choices? So how do you, as a panel member of the JAKIM Halal Certification panel, how do you balance it up? How do you make sure that as we go on, more choices are available that can perhaps make DCA change the decision and allow halal logo to be put on the products?
Okay, thank you. Okay, yes, I couldn't agree more. Yes, such collaboration is crucial because halal requirement are inseparable from the requirement set for safety, quality, efficacy by MPRA, in short, TOIBAN. Mm. So to be TOIBAN, the product must be registered with Drug Control Authority. As mentioned earlier, the standard for registration also being referred to the international standard, as well as subject to the current needs and updates. So for me, the appointment of MPRA representative as a panel member is seen as a strategic planning by JAKIM to ensure that halal requirements are aligned with the global requirement practice. The MPRA does not make halal as mandatory requirement. However, details and related information such as source of ingredient, especially both active ingredient and excipient, and also manufacturing process to be required to be declared in the part of the registration process. So all this information is useful and to be used to provide technical input and advice to halal committee to give the halal committee to decide before they can decide. Eh? And then the close cooperation between MPRA and JAKIM is seen as a promising platform to increase the availability of choice for stakeholder and to make informed decision for the consumption of halal product. And I would like to emphasize that this is not only one of our collaboration with JAKIM and stakeholder to make certified halal medicine available in Malaysia. Previously, halal logo is not allowed on medicine label at all. But since 2014, we have revised our guideline and we allow logo halal is voluntary to be put in the label. Okay, the reason why DCA haven't allowed yet for the product, pharmaceutical product containing scheduled poison because of they afraid that when we have a halal logo for product, because normally product containing scheduled poison used for treatments. Medicine for three, then if patient those product haven't got their logo in the label, we afraid that the patient refuse to take. They may assume that the that product is haram because they are not contain not having halal logo in their label. That's why we still as mentioned, that like by based on Encik Amra, we have fatwa that allow even though the product is containing porcine or not halal ingredient. So the fatwa still allow medicine. If there is no other choice, they can use. That's why even though we don't allow halal logo to be put in the product containing prescription, this so product can still use. Mm.
So you mentioned earlier that the, if I'm not mistaken, 2009, that the requirement, 2009, the requirement to declare animal origin.
Yes.
But that one is only to declare to DCA, or is it to be put on the product?
To put on the label.
To put on the product packaging. So it's actually a requirement. Mm-hmm. So if you, since there's no halal logo yet, you can look into the product labeling, the product packaging, to see whether it's of animal sources or not. But then you can't, straight away say no, you can't take it because there's an animal source. You really need to expand your knowledge and understand the whole scenario, the whole requirements of informed choices. And this is where all the stakeholders need to work together. And I'm glad the collaboration between JAKIM and the Ministry of Health has started. There's also Kadir, a representative from JAKIM in Ministry of Health, and vice versa. There's Ministry of Health officials in JAKIM, so they are working closely together already. You also mentioned earlier about being in the global scenario, in the global meetings, in the global international level, ASEAN and also international scenario. Have there been questions there about halal and how Malaysia is leading and how they can refer to Malaysia and how to embrace halal into medicine?
Okay, there were events held in to discuss halal and also informed decision making, which MPRA has participated, such as Global Halal Summit. This is very technical meeting, and then we also bring the issues during our presentation at International Vaccine Institute in Korea, and this led to the collaboration publication with Pfizer and Disease Control Division, as your health, where the article was published by Journal Human Vaccine and Immunotherapeutic in 2019. So actually, internationally, they accept our intention to embark on halal pharmaceutical.
So the big guns, like you mentioned, Pfizer, is already interested into making halal. Yeah, which is good, alhamdulillah. You heard earlier, if you were attended the morning session, Russians are already wanting to work with Malaysia in getting the COVID-19 vaccines halal. And I believe since they make that statement, other countries may want to join the bandwagon. Mm. Inshallah, Ministry of Health, the pharmacies, the universities, JAKIM, of course, will be working together to make that a reality. So what about you, Encik Am? You also have been into the international events. What's your feedback that you get from them?
Well, I think the most important thing is to actually provide information, provide awareness, and so on. I want to touch into how actually we need to educate the healthcare professional in handling halal haram issues. And this is something that have been done in WMMC before. The fact that you must have a proper SOP. Okay, or a guideline for the use of non-halal medicine inside any clinical setting. Okay, this is what we have done in UMMC previously, even before all this being done, meaning back at the very beginning, we have actually come up with the guideline. And this guideline is very, very important because of the fact that we have to follow what is the saying of the Quran, what is the saying of the Hadith, all right? And all these rulings are very clear. But when we go into a clinical setting and so on and so forth, the application is very important. So that's why when the go back to the informed choice, so they already have a guideline, okay, that we have actually established in MMC way back in the 90s. Yeah. After that, then we felt that, you know, this need to be shared. All right. So what we did was actually we take the guideline, all right, and we bring to JAKIM. Okay, we bring to JAKIM, and from there we get the input from them, and then make it even better because we want to know from the clerics, okay, what is actually their opinion, whether what we have done is actually in line with the Sharia ruling and so on and so forth. So true enough, after all the waiting, finally in 2018, okay, KKM actually has issued that guideline. So now we have a guideline of using the non-halal medicine, okay, and it should be made available to all, to pharmacists, to doctors, to nurses, to everyone, because this is something that is being on a day-to-day basis that we have to use this, all right? And so we hope that, you know, with this sort of understanding, and so the issue of patient not knowing the halal status, or even without the halal halal logo, they are more confident to use if you use that guideline properly. So the guideline is already there, okay, and we can refer, so that we can resolve the issue of, for example, that what mentioned in terms of whether there will be a confusion when you put the halal logo inside the label inside there, because the guideline is already there, and in that guideline is very clear, is very crystal clear, that in the state of emergency, in the state of life threatening situation, all right, you can use non-halal medicine even without getting the consent from the patient or from the carer, because that's what the healthcare professional. So I think that guideline should actually alleviate, you know, the concern about the label of this product. And I presented this guideline in international, and we can explain, you know, why we are doing this point and that point and so on, because in terms of all this process, okay, you know, we must know the product is halal, is haram, after that then to be used for Muslim patient. So if you follow the guideline, it's all there. That means if, for example, say, when you say in terms of efficacy, we're talking about level one, what you call under R&D, okay, under evidence, it should be level one or level A, you know. So all these are all that which we have been scrutinized. So I think the confidence level have increased. So we hope with this new, you know, ecosystem, in the ecosystem that came up, so I think we will be more confident. So the only thing that I wish that all this need to be, you have to relate to everyone. Right? Even in my experience, going even to community pharmacists, okay, I share all this because of the fact that, you know, they need to know, you know, how to handle this in community pharmacy setting, especially when patients come into community pharmacy setting, you know, and they want to know the product, for example, all right? So a valid question will be, how on earth is the patient or the pharmacist going to answer if the patient asks, is this medicine halal? They must answer with confidence. So they must have the knowledge, you know. And if they have a choice in their pharmacy, they have to provide the choice to the patient and let the patient, the consumer, to choose. Right? So I think and another point probably we can do, because this is something that related to the ecosystem, because we want everyone to understand the whole thing. We do not want any dubious things that, you know, people get confused, people get doubtful. At the end of the day, right? People will not trust the healthcare professional. This is a no-no, right? So I think I just want to share another point, and this is actually very important for the fact that, okay, we mentioned when you talk about halal, for example, okay, we talk about halalan or jakim section, or we talk about toiban, sure enough, okay, we talk about what you call quality, safety and efficacy. But another dimension which is even important is actually ethics. So my message to colleagues in pharmacy, please embrace the code of ethics. We have done the code of ethics recently, and it's very clear in that code of ethics, make patient your primary concern. It's very clear when we did that. So these are all part of the building blocks, you know, that we have in Malaysia, that we can move forward. And this is very vital when you look into how actually we go from one state to another, and then reaching the patient. And this is something that we need to share, and I think a practitioner have to play a role. So I think now people are more comfortable. So probably it will open up, you know, to new areas of interest, you know, because now we can see, it become different already, because you're talking about from a different perspective. So ethics is something that need to be done in practice. For example, and when you say ethic, for example, or in informed choice, right? So it is ethical for us to inform the patient or the carer, okay? But whether they have to hear that, you know, that this medicine is non-halal, and the sort we have to tell them and explain to them, you know, and what are the choices and so on and so forth, why we are using this one. But I again refer to that guideline, okay, saying that it's very clear, you know, when for emergency use, and if involve a life saving, it is, they can use regardless whether they get consent or not. So I think this is something that probably will address the one that Puan Rose mentioned from DCA point of view. Regarding, I hope, you know, this will actually have some solution to the existing problem. So that's my view. Yeah.
Good. The audience here, do you have any questions that you would like to pose to the speaker and also the panelists? No, not for the time being. Okay. Prof, you looking at the hardware side, you know, I'm calling it the hardware side because it's the documents. It's very important document, this halal pharmacopoeia, right? And I'm glad in your presentation just now you mentioned that the at the World Halal Summit, that was when we were together, right, 2018, in Turkey, the SMIC, Standard Meteorological Institute, there's a full name to it, I can't remember offhand, SMIC has already taken into consideration that apart from standard, halal pharmacopoeia is an important document to further make the building blocks stronger for halal pharmaceuticals. So, Prof, could you perhaps share, you know, since you are also in that TC that you mentioned earlier also, the technical committee that is currently looking at the standards, how do the other countries, you can also share which other countries are in the technical committee, how are they perceiving halal pharmaceuticals? Yeah, they are looking at standards now, but perhaps, you know, can be expedited together between standards and also the pharmacopoeia so that it's faster and can help to alleviate the concern by DCA and allow the logo to be put on medicine. Perhaps, Prof?
Yeah, thank you. Currently, we are trying to address and try to harmonize the various standards in terms of the guidelines and so on, between countries that have got standards. For example, Malaysia itself, and also from Pakistan. The Pakistan standard is quite comprehensive in the sense that it covers nearly every aspects that we MS cover. And then the other countries, they are still contemplating to have such standards, especially from Saudi Arabia, and then also from Turkey. I think the one country that we are still wanting to have collaboration is, of course, Indonesia. Mm. And Indonesia is a very particular sort of a situation whereby they have got this presidential decree to have halal pharmaceuticals, halal drugs in the market by a certain period of time. And we see that they have come up with a so-called list by the minister, the Majlis Ulama Indonesia, and that list as a guide for the industry to try to follow and to make sure that when they register, they use this particular list. And I think that's very important to guide the industry, especially when they are trying to formulate or produce and manufacture medicines which later on they hope to be halal. And I think this is where we can join together, join hands, join efforts and so on with our colleagues from the other OIC countries and try to resolve the issues together. Because they are going to face the same issues, the same problems, because mainly the world advanced countries, America, Britain, Europe and so on, they produce the pharmaceuticals for the world. And they want to know, they want to have feedback from countries which consume these items to see the aspects related to halal. And I think just now, during the ambassadors sort of forum, we can see how they respond. And they are responding it well, in the sense that they want to make sure that whatever medicines, especially in this case vaccines, is acceptable to the Muslim community of that particular country. And I think it goes across the board when we find that until unless the professionals, the industry players, the entrepreneurs get their act together and understand the issues, what constitute halal and what constitute non-halal, then only we can offer the solution. Yeah? And I think if countries like Thailand, for example, they have come up with a document called the ASH standards. Yeah? And this document is very important. It also covers some areas of the pharmaceutical drugs, pharmaceutical, because it covers the additives. Formerly it's called E numbers. Now they have converted to ASH numbers, and meaning to say that they have also classified it into the halal, the masbuh, and the haram of the E numbers, and they turn it into H numbers. I think this sort of activity is very, very useful, very important, so that the industry can be guided, can be guided by the professionals, the researchers, and so on, so that they can conform to the halal aspect of medicines, of supplements, and also of food. Yeah? I think that is the sort of thing that we see things going forward.
We need documents, we need information, we need the right minds to bring us forward in accelerating the growth of halal, especially halal pharmaceuticals. And since we're talking about growth, did you know that HDC is offering a new service called the Halal Integrated Platform to help grow the halal industry? It's a community platform that enriches registered members by connecting them to the key stakeholders like the government, state agencies, certification bodies, industry players, practitioners, scholars and consumers under one roof. So the benefits for being members include you have preferred halal training rates, HDC's personalized HALA consultancy services, talent job matching, marketplace, a B2C platform, access to HALA ingredient database, a B2B platform, access to HALA park directory, online marketing and promotion activities, access to newsletters and publication, and most importantly, funding assistance. So please do visit HDC's website, www.hdcglobal.com, for more info. So to wrap up, I'd like to give a minute each to our panelists and speaker to share their concluding remarks. Ladies first.
Puan Thank Ruth. You, Madam Chairperson. Okay, I am very enlightened with all the points given out by our honourable panelists here. For me, I believe that HALAL certified pharmaceutical product is benefit not only for Muslim, not actually for everyone. Eh? It is because wholesomeness of this product, meaning of the tohiban aspect, and also guaranteed as safe for the consumption, hygienically produced with a high quality standard of production and ingredient or material use, as well as being assured of the product's efficacy and effectiveness. So, thank you.
Yeah. Do visit NPRA website and also Ministry of Health website, the Bahagian Pharmacy, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, pharmacy.
The Bahagian Pharmacy or the Pharmacy Department has that document which Encik Am mentioned just now about the guideline for in making decisions for medicines, be it halal or non-halal. I think the COVID-19 has teach us a lot about importance of information and adhering to SOP, right? So these are very key, and there's a lot of information that you can get online. HDCglobal.com has a lot of information. The MOH website also have a lot of information. So do visit this website. Encik Am, how about you? Any wrapping, concluding remarks?
Well, I think the current pandemic COVID-19 infection, actually has opened up a lot of eyes. For whatever reason, we are prepared. I don't think when we actually put the addendum of for halal export for the vaccine, we are not aware that this COVID-19 is going to come. So now we are in a position. We are in a position to contribute to the world. So I think. For the future, I could see that the halal pharmaceutical will be a game changer. Okay, will be a game changer because of the fact that I think we are talking about, if you talk about from the business point of view, we are talking about trillions of USD. All this been shared, and I'm sure because of the fact that that we are in this position with this ecosystem. I'm sure that the Malaysia, our country Malaysia, and also the world will benefit from all this effort to make sure that that we're able to make it available. And 20% market in the world market is a huge, because when you talk even from the Muslim population, when you talk about 20% is a big number when you talk from the industry. More so when we say that halal pharmaceutical is for all. Is not only for for Muslim, and I always say to Prof that when we talk to the industry, okay, now you have your current GMP, all right, what's next? So we are offering halal pharmaceutical as the next level, but it is a business decision, so up to the industry to take up, because I always feel that if we tackle the industry right from the along the downstream, will be easier based on my own personal experience in UMMC before. Right? How I wish at that time during my time we have halal certified pharmaceutical. It will make my life definitely good. So that's my point. My last thing.